I don't remember. What do I say?
This is just conversations.
All right.
We're doing the biz.
You ready?
Got something. Yeah, let's go.
All right. 3, 2, 1.
Conversations. Conversations.
What up? And welcome back to Conversations. With Oldtoby and Hatz. Sorry, I got excited.
We just noticed there's a cave down here, so we're gonna go caving while we
our base is right there, but I don't want to show it yet. You gonna show it?
That's all right. No, that's right. We'll wait for the reveal.
Tease it a little bit.
Ooh, we're in 1.10 now, so we've got these little dust particles now from from gravity blocks.
1.10 is official already. Yeah. Crazy.
That's amazing.
Obviously, Microsoft has had an effect on them. Because they only did 3 snapshots, whereas the previous updates, they did anywhere from 20 to 30.
Yeah, that's true. Oh, it's just a tiny little cave.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't even go anywhere. Lame.
Oh, man. I was hoping for a good...
Yeah, so in the last episode, Toby here made a nice little intro for us. using some... Some voice work from us.
Yeah, it made me laugh so hard when I made that thing, because I was like, because I was trying to find like a magic, like fairy dust or something that made it look really really cheesy. So instead, I used
that like sparkle,
the light back behind it. Yeah. All
right. Well, that was a bust.
Yeah.
So
that was
I guess
lame.
We're gonna have to show off our base.
Okay.
Progress mostly Toby's kind of planning it out. I help just kind of fill in the floor and stuff.
Yeah, so there's the front right now. Yeah,
it's kind of cool.
I'm not sure yet. It looks almost like a face.
Yeah, it kind of does.
Almost
like a giant chess piece.
Yeah, like that, or like like those the faces on Easter Island or something.
Yeah.
Just that's really big.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, so we've got that. It goes into got the kind of the supports for the top floor and all that kind of stuff kind of in place, because that's the main way. Whenever I build stuff, I think the way it works is it has to look like it's supported. If it looks supported, then it looks like a pretty good build.
Yeah.
So so we got this going, and we'll probably work on some walls to make it safe, and then we'll probably build up and probably build down. I know, Dan, you were doing some digging over here, yeah?
Yeah, I was just digging down into a little mine.
Okay, so we'll have that. We can maybe connect to it down through here somehow. Yeah, and I really don't know what this is going to look like. I'm just trying to wing it. But it feels okay. So I'm going to go grab some more. Oh, what was that? We got new sounds all over the place, too. Yeah.
I mean, that was in 1.9, but...
Yeah,
still,
but
I'm
you
still
were
not
doing,
used to it.
You were doing something like you were shifting through something in your inventory.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So what did we hear? It was like a dun 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 sound.
Really?
Yeah.
I have no
did
idea.
Did you have?
I think it was. I thought it was the furnace.
I don't think so. Did you like have a shield in your hand or something?
I like move stuff around. No, I didn't have anything in my.
Weird. That was weird.
Yeah.
Well, you'll be able to see in the video what I heard.
Yeah, that was weird.
Yeah, bedtime. Okay.
Oh, yeah, sleep. So we don't get
let's hear the goods about what happened on
this past weekend, Phoenix Comicon. I think there was also one in Dallas same weekend, which is a little weird, but yeah, I'm close to Phoenix, so my wife and I went, and she went all 4 days, which is ridiculous.
That's awesome.
I just went Saturday and Sunday, but we got to meet a bunch of different people. Trying to remember everybody.
Yeah,
just
what
digging while I talk.
That's all right. Yeah, I'm just taking out some trees.
So the big headliner that was there this year was Sean Astin.
Sam.
Known for Samwise Gamgee from Lord of the Rings. Or, can't remember his
Rudy.
Name. Rudy. Oh, yeah, Rudy.
The
kid from Goonies. I can't remember. I'm trying to think of his name. I can't think of his name in the movie.
I'm just thinking of Pepperpot. I just keep thinking of the the Samuel Pepperpot, the guy they're hunting down.
Oh, hey, look at this. I found some more diamond.
Shut your face. All right, so did you meet him?
So, yes, got to meet him. Trying to remember because there's a lot of different things. But we got his autograph. So we got his autograph, and we got to talk to him for a couple minutes.
Nice.
And my wife created this... this photo for him to sign, and it was she thinks it's hilarious, but I think it's kind of funny, but not that funny, but she just wouldn't stop laughing about it. But there's a part in the Lord of the Rings where he's talking to Frodo, and he's telling him, you know, you need share the load, and he says it in a weird voice like that. So there's this sign in one of the nearby neighborhoods by us that says share the road.
Oh, it's nice.
A big yellow sign says share the road. So she created this picture of on the top part it's the share the road sign, and on the bottom part it's the image from Lord of the Rings when, you know, Sam is in that, when he's talking to Frodo and he's all like depressed and sad. So it's like a really depressing picture.
And she made, share the road.
She made two different versions of it, and so we paid for one autograph. And I don't know. I hope I don't get in trouble, and nobody better rat me out. But we paid for one autograph, and we showed him the pictures, and he kind of was at first kind of like, what? He kind of chuckled a little bit, and we were like, you know, have you ever seen anything like this? You know, making fun of that. And he was just like, no. He's like, you know, I've never seen it. So he's like, you know, which one you want me to sign? We told him, you know, you pick your favorite one. So he actually took a little bit of time to think about it and was like, you know, I like the one where you can actually see my face and my eyes, because the other one, he was kind of like looking down and you couldn't really see him. He's kind of like crying. He's like, that one's just a little too depressing.
Yeah.
So he signed the one, signed all of our names, and, you know, put a little message on there, and I think he signed it with like a little happy face or something. Yeah. And he talked to us for a minute while we were talking. At first we didn't realize, but he signed the other one as well, but he didn't sign our names. He just signed just his name, which still is really cool. And yeah. So we got like two for one. And I mean, he was super nice. He was a very, very nice guy. And my wife brought, our dog, who's a service dog, and dressed her up as K-9 from Doctor Who.
Oh, sweet.
And everybody loved her. So we kept talking about the dog with everybody, and but that was fun.
That was really cool.
Really cool, interesting story. One of our friends that went with us asked him, every actor that we got to talk to, she asked them, you know, was there anything you kept from, you know, working on the movies?
Right.
And his answer was that what he kept was from Lord of the Rings. He said, so at the end of the very last one, the third one, there's that scene where he's got I think it's his daughter in the movie. It's like a little baby or very young girl.
And at the very end.
Yeah, at the very, very end. And it was his actual daughter in real life.
Nice.
And he said that they kept the dress that she wore. It was like this really fancy little dress. And he said that every once in a while he sees it, or they pull it out or something, and it just kind of brings tears to his eyes because, you know, it reminds him of when his daughter was, you know, a little girl, and now she's like 13 or 14 or something like that.
Yeah, that's pretty sweet.
So that was pretty cool.
Yeah, no, that's really sweet.
And then, so we talked to them. We got to talk to... some of the Doctor Who people.
Which Doctor Who people?
So Billie Piper is known as Rose. She was the first companion in the new series.
Mm-hmm.
She has Eccleston the world's and Tennant.
World's best overbite.
Yeah,
I just have to say.
Yeah, she does, and she was hilarious. She was really funny. And I'm gonna have to look this up real quick because I'm not moving anything, but I gotta get her name right because I cannot ever remember her name.
The one who played
River Song. That's Alex Kingston. She was there, she was fantastic. We went to her panel, and she was absolutely hilarious. And she's been in a bunch of different stuff as well, which is really cool.
She was in ER.
She was in ER for many years.
Yeah.
The first 8 years of ER, I believe.
I think so.
And then she's played, obviously, River Song on Doctor Who. And then, what was the other thing? She was on NCIS for like an episode.
Oh, really?
She's on a couple of other things like that.
That's cool.
It's pretty cool. And she was really fun. We got her autograph. We got Billy Piper's autograph.
Nice.
And then Dan Starkey was there, who plays Strax.
Mm-hmm. I've never seen him.
You never really see him. Yeah, because he's always dressed up. Ah,
yeah.
Okay, that's her name. Neve McIntosh. She plays Madame Vastra, which is the lizard.
Lizard
woman.
Lady. Yeah.
Lizard lady. She was awesome. She was a lot of fun. Got to talk to her for a little bit. And then we also got a picture with all four of them, which was really cool.
That's awesome.
And it was really cool, too. When we were talking to Neve McIntosh, she mentioned that she had never met Billy Piper. And we were like, wait, what? that's kind of weird. Yeah, and she was like, yeah, I'm really excited to go meet her. And it's like, wait a second, you were on the same show. But like, when you think about it, there's probably four seasons in between them.
That's true. There's
so really they were never overlap. Really even close to overlapping.
Yeah.
But so yeah, that was pretty cool.
That's awesome.
And then the other people we got to talk to were from the Karate Kid. The three main guys from Karate Kid. The sensei guy of the Cobra.
Oh, Cobra Kai?
Cobra Kai. And then the rival. His name is Martin Grove?
The sensei? So the one who sweeps the leg, right?
Yeah, the...
Yeah, the bad kid.
Well, okay, no, the bad kid, that's William Zabka.
Oh, okay.
The sensei is, I think his name is Martin Grove. He's been in a ton of stuff, like mostly action stuff. He was in like Rambo. He was in some old 80s movie with Chuck Norris.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, he's been in a ton of stuff. He was cool. But then, yeah, William Zabka. So he plays the punk kid in the movie. And I don't know if you've seen, but there's this video that has gone around talking about how the Karate Kid, Daniel, was actually the bully.
Yeah, he was the bad kid. He was the one who was messing everything up.
And it's really and actually quite a compelling argument when you watch it and you're like, holy crap, yeah, maybe the Karate Kid was the bully.
Yeah.
So we brought that up with William, who played the rival. And he goes, he got all excited. He was like, yeah. He goes, this guy over here, Ralph Macchio, who played Daniel, the Karate Kid, and he pointed over to him because he was just, 10 feet away. He was at the next little booth. He goes, he's had the public, hoodwinked for years. And he goes, finally the truth comes out. And he goes, I wasn't the bad guy. And then Ralph Macchio just kind of looked over and like rolled his eyes like, not this again.
Yeah, like I've heard this so many times.
Yeah. It was pretty funny though. He was probably the most personable guy, William Zabka. Uh-huh. He was the only actor who came out because there was like a table where they sat at. He was the only one who, without taking a picture or anything, he came out in front of the table to meet everybody and shake your hand and hug a few people and everything like that. He was really nice, and we actually got to talk to him for a little bit because there wasn't really a big crowd for him, which is kind of sad, but he's a cool guy.
And does he still looks the same, I'm sure.
He does. It's really kind of creepy. Yeah. He just is a lot older.
Yeah.
Which we looked amazing. It up afterwards because we were like, how old is he? And he's 50.
Oh my gosh.
He's like, oh my gosh. In the movie, he's like 18.
Well, and I think Ralph Macchio, I think he was 50 when he made the movie to begin with. No. I know he was a lot older.
I think he was 21. He was supposed to play a 16-year-old.
Yeah.
I think he was 21 or 22.
So he suffered the Michael J. Fox.
Yeah.
Sadness of playing a teenager when he's like, almost 30 or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it's a lot of fun. Took some pictures.
That's awesome.
Got to, to me, one of the best parts of Comic-Con is the exhibition hall. They have just tons of artists, authors, you know, you name it, all kinds of different people that, you know, either create things or have different services or whatever, and they, you know, you get to talk to them, and a lot of these people are just unbelievably talented.
Yeah.
I mean, unbelievably talented, and, you know, they don't get any recognition, really, because, you know, they're just not famous or whatever, but some really amazing artwork, a lot of comics. Well, and
did you have a lot of good a lot of good like cosplay there too?
Because I know that's absolutely like the
main thing.
Oh yeah, tons of people dressed up and some really really elaborate, incredibly detailed stuff. It's pretty cool. That's trying to think, probably the best one. One of the best ones that we saw was actually, this is kind of weird, because it's kind of obscure at this point, but it was a group of people that were all dressed like the crew in the old Disney movie Atlantis.
Oh, cool. That's like one of my favorites.
Yeah, like all the steampunk people. It was really, really cool. They all had very detailed costumes on. I mean, one of the guys had like a giant paperclip. Like, it was pretty cool.
Oh, that is fantastic.
Like, really detailed, really, really cool. And that's another thing. A lot of people just dress as steampunk, you know, whatever. Yeah. That's kind of a big thing. And we saw a couple people that had some really creative costumes for that. Just kind of being a, you know, kind of general steampunk. But,
yeah.
So that was pretty cool. But yeah, some really cool stuff. And I definitely have to say the most popular cosplay was Deadpool.
Oh yeah.
I mean, there are Deadpools everywhere, and even at one point they like all gathered in one spot and they played a big game of Duck Duck Goose. There was like 12 of them. Just like, what the heck. It's pretty funny, dang, though. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And one of our friends, there's like a friend of a friend, their like little sister and her friends or whatever, dressed up as Minecraft guys. Uh-huh. And it was Lewis and Simon and what's the bad guy's name? I can't remember that they had.
Israfel.
Israfel. So those three. Yeah. And they were like full on, like, cardboard box head. I mean, their entire bodies were a Minecraft character. It was pretty impressive.
Oh, so good.
I don't know how they could walk around. But it was pretty cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so it's a fun weekend. Very tiring and extremely hot. But I have to say they did a fantastic job at keeping the indoors extremely cool. Mm. But holy crap, it was like 111 this weekend.
Oh my gosh. Ugh. Yeah, it's finally, summer has finally hit.
Yep.
For real. Yeah.
For reals.
Well, that's awesome. I'm glad. You had a good time.
Fun times. But I just love that Sean Astin. And that was the other thing too. When we gave him that picture, he actually said "share the road" in that voice. It was so good. He was just like, "share the road."
That's awesome.
And then he just kind of laughed. Like, oh, it was fantastic. Like,
I get it now.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So funny.
Okay, so now I gotta figure out exactly what the crap I'm doing. This is where it's not as exciting to watch as I scaffold all over the place. Let's see, do I want to just mimic that up above or no? Maybe I don't want to do that at all. Maybe I want to...
Well, found some gold.
Sweet! So what's next? What else do we need to discuss? Many things. I know. Many things. We go. Let's just do it. Let's just jump right in. This is gonna go for things are walking around outside now. This is probably gonna be a conversation that goes on for quite some time.
Alright.
But I say we dive into movie talk.
Alright.
And some of the stuff again, there's like a big precursor that we need to put on this discussion, I think, is that there are certain things that we love, and that I'm sure we'll talk about, you know. But for me, I think what's going to be interesting is I want to know the stuff that you like that isn't necessarily,
majorly popular. Like
Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know. Right. I mean, that's obvious.
Star Wars, obvious. Lord of the Rings.
Yeah,
Sir Givens.
Yeah, and so those will be there. Oh man, I'm getting lambasted over here.
Is it nighttime?
Yep.
Oh, all right, coming back.
Oh my gosh, there's so many things. Yeah, so, I mean, because for me, seriously, one of the greatest films of all time, at least action films of all time, is Raiders of the Lost Ark. And, And the reason for it being so good is that from a storytelling standpoint, there's nothing out of place. And like all the action sequences are there because they need to be to move the story forward, right?
Yeah.
So
it's, no, they just didn't just gratuitous action like most action movies nowadays.
Well, and it's like, you know, like Raiders did it right, and then they kind of missed the mark from that point on. I mean, I still enjoy Last Crusade is really fun, but it never achieved the Raiders thing, because I think I think they just did it really well.
Stole my bed.
Snuck in there. I think that they came up with the idea, and I know that the story sessions were, I want to see this in a movie, and I'd like to see this. And then, luckily, it wasn't George Lucas who wrote it. It was Lawrence Kasdan. So Lawrence Kasdan went, okay, well, let's figure out what story would work to get these things in. And then he would say, well, we can't do that one because it doesn't fit the story. So let's use this one instead because this kind of fits. And, I mean, there's nothing to trim in Raiders of the Lost Ark. There's no fat. It's just pure story and action and amazing, and it's Harrison Ford and it's wonderful. So like there's no way to beat that one. That was like I saw Star Wars, loved it when I was a kid, right?
Yeah.
And then it wasn't until I saw Raiders of the Lost Ark that I realized, holy crap, this is some of the, I mean, I've never felt like this before.
Yeah.
And there's several, and so that's the thing that I'm kind of latching onto, I think, when we talk about movies and stuff, is the movies that gave you that feeling,
right?
You know what I mean? And I think my game sounds are too loud, but yeah, sure enough, movies that gave you that feeling, or movies that just kind of moved you in a way that you weren't, either you weren't expecting, or it just, for whatever reason, it just clicked with you and you loved it. So that's kind of what I'm thinking, at least when I am considering the movies that I would think that we would talk about. So I'll throw that out. And I think, too, probably the safest thing bet would be to kind of go pseudo-chronologically, maybe. We don't have to.
Okay.
But, because that's kind of how I'm thinking. I'm thinking, oh, well, everything changed after I saw Raiders. So the movies that meant something to me when I was a kid were, you know, Legend and what was the big one for me was, The Dark Crystal was huge for me.
Oh, okay.
Even though it's kind of terrifying.
yeah.
And I think if my dad had seen it prior to me going and seeing it, he probably would have said, no, I don't think so.
I don't think so.
Oops. But it was those kind of things that were just pure imagination. And I could even, as a kid, look at it and say, man, there's just something here. So, but we don't have to do it that way. We can do it however you want. Like, as soon as we start talking about movies and we're talking about the stuff that meant something to you, what's the first thing that comes to your mind?
First one that always comes to my mind is Garden State.
Really?
Yeah. And it's not that it's necessarily a good movie, because, I mean, there's a million things you can do to pick it apart, and I understand that. it was just one of those things. I know you and I have talked about this. I don't know if we talked about it on here yet, but
yeah,
it's one of those things where actually I was talking about this with somebody just the other day. Like, when you see a movie or read a book at a specific point in your life, when you're going through something or you're experiencing something, and like the movie or the book just kind of hits it, you know, just grabs you because of that moment in your life, it has a profound effect on you.
Yeah.
That it doesn't have on other people.
That's true.
And there's a lot of movies like that, and where it's like, if you saw it, you'd be like, oh, okay, it was okay, you know, whatever. But just for me, at that time in my life, it just, something about it just really grabbed me. And
I would agree with that.
I love Zach Braff, and I love everything he's been involved with. Mostly. There's a couple of duds that he worked with, but that Last Kiss movie was terrible.
Oh, I don't think I ever saw that.
Yeah, it was awful. He didn't write that one. He was just an actor in it. But yeah, Garden State came out in 2003, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And it just kind of came out of the blue. It was an independent film, mostly. Zach Braff, you know, was the director. He was the main star. Him and his brother wrote the script. And it was done on a very small budget. It actually was in theaters for a little bit, and it had a little bit of a cult following, but it wasn't a huge success. But yeah, I just loved it. I love the transition of the story and the kind of the evolution of the characters, and I don't know, there's just something about it.
That's awesome.
And that was before Natalie Portman was popular.
I think she had just
Done Star Wars, which...
Yeah, I think she just kind of... which, I mean, I knew her from... One of my favorite movies was The Professional that she was in when she was, like, 12.
Oh, right, yeah.
Which was, like, loads of people were up in arms about and really shocked about, but it was actually a really good movie. I don't know. I'm doing something really different here. What do you think?
Why are those doors...
Oh, I can change them.
Yeah.
I put them up differently.
It's kind of cool. It's got a nice airy feel to it. I like it.
Yeah, instead of doing like actual thick walls. I don't know if it's going to cause a problem with skeletons, but they can't get up here, I don't think.
Yeah, oh, yeah, that's true.
So I think we'll be okay.
Yeah,
I
should be all right. Yeah, that should be fine.
Yeah, I'm just kind of playing around here and seeing.
Famous last words.
Yeah.
Did I not have... I didn't bring a flint and steel with me? I swear I had one.
I thought I put one in there. Well, we can make some. I've got some steel. Some flint? Iron cooking over there. You did too. Yeah, you got some. I don't have any flint.
What the heck? Well.
Time to go mining.
Yeah. That's weird.
Yeah, that's funny. Anyways,
yeah. So, yeah. That's always the first one that comes to my mind is Garden State.
Yeah. No, I can totally see that.
It's just a great... It's a great one of those just kind of character growth movies where, you know, start out just kind of lost and kind of finds his way. Which is really good.
Yeah. No, it's cool. I'm trying to think... Like, the ones I always think of immediately.
Oh, there we go.
But seriously, like, one of my favorite movies ever. I think we can still open that, yeah.
On our own.
No. Are you talking about On Our Own, the...
best movie ever.
Which one are you talking about?
Let me make Isn't sure. that what it's called?
Which one?
The one you were just absolutely trashing when you were talking with Jill, and you said your wife made you watch.
Oh yes,
and she loved it.
That's exactly right. It was terrible. It was terrible, terrible. It was some really bad independent movie.
So I have to say though, I actually kind of like that movie because it was bad.
Oh god. Well, and I that's the only way that I can justify them liking it. Is that they had some appreciation
so corny.
For how terrible it was. Yeah. But do you remember that one?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah,
because I liked it. Like, I legit liked it because it was so corny. Oh, it had some of the weirdest, just stupid things happen to these kids.
Yeah, it's the Osmond kids.
And they were, like, going across the country to find their uncle who didn't care for them.
No.
Uh-oh. I got a problem. I just went through the portal, and I went back to the original portal. Which means if I go back through here, I'm gonna end up back.
We're not that close.
No, we're not. Holy crap. Alright, everybody look away.
yeah, look away. Well, nothing's happening. Maybe raise it up or something?
I don't know. That was weird. I don't know why.
That's really bizarre. I'm going to swap this over. How far are we? I thought we moved quite a bit. Maybe we didn't.
We did. No, we did. We are 1,300 blocks away. No, 1,100 blocks away.
Yeah,
there's no way those. There's no way those should link up.
Well, why would that be a thing?
I'll fix that later off screen.
Okay. Yeah, that's really weird.
I was going to try and make a path back to that other one, but I guess not. That's really weird.
Okay. Yeah, that's really strange. Not sure what to do here. This is just a weird idea in general. I can't stand that movie. Andrea made me watch it. See, like, because Andrea's family, they were a lot more careful with what they let their kids watch,
right,
than my family was. I mean, you know, my dad didn't go see R movies and junk like that when I was too young, and like, but I remember, like, when Die Hard came out, I got it. I rented the video cassette of it when it came out on video, and got it and watched it with my dad and said, "Dad, Bruce Willis is the next Clint Eastwood." And he was like, "Oh, nobody can replace Clint or John Wayne." And we watched that movie, and he goes, "Well, I think we got a contender," because that's another one of my favorite action movies.
Classic.
Die Hard is so good, and that's, again, the action scenes really mean something.
Yeah,
it's not just let's do some fun stuff. But yeah, I love Die Hard. That was my first rated R movie in the theater.
Nice.
That was a big deal, man. Okay, well, so this is all right. I'm gonna probably move the beds. I don't know where to. Probably in here. I guess we don't have to. I still feel kind of open and like if it rains, it weirds me out. All right, let me finish the roof in here and I'll adjust. Okay, let's see. So from when I was a kid, and I just showed my kids The NeverEnding Story just like 2 days ago.
Oh, nice.
They had never seen it, and they had the greatest reaction to it because they both kind of went, "This is kind of cheesy." I was like, "Yes, it is. Yes. I know that completely."
That's the point.
But then they were like suddenly swept into the story, and they were, and it really meant something, and it was really sweet. And they, you know, because we rented it like on Apple TV or whatever, and you know, we only had it for 24 hours, so they, like, as soon as they got up the next morning, when I got up, they were watching it. Yeah. We gotta watch it before it's too, you know, before it's gone. So that's always fun when my kids feel or somehow connect with something that was really important to me.
Yeah.
Because that, you know, that was a great one for me. But I think I'm gonna use this stuff here. I don't want things spawning up there, so I'm gonna do it half a block down again. Gosh, it's like I don't know where to start.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. Let's think of like genres.
Okay, that's a good way to do it.
I think that may be a better way to kind of block it off. So let's go with let's do just easy comedies first. And I will start with one of my favorite comedies of all time. Is Mel Brooks' Young Frankenstein. Seriously, one of the more intelligently funny movies that you don't even understand why you're laughing sometimes. It's just funny.
Yeah.
That's one of my absolute favorite movies.
Honestly say I've never seen that one.
Oh, God, you have to see it. It's so stupid and amazing and funny, and Gene Wilder is just perfection. I mean, he is so strangely funny. So that one is a really good one. And then when I was in high school, my brother showed me, on the same night, he showed me Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
Nice.
And Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
Nice.
So I had this what a double, night. Yeah, I had this double hit of my sides hurt so much the next morning because I just seriously laughed nonstop. Because I love stupid humor like that. But the thing with and then from that point on, I fell in love with Monty Python and they became huge for me.
Yeah.
And that led me into loving all things UK, and I fell in love with loads of different British shows and British actors, and that was just like a, you know, like a bomb going off. And I want to say I was probably 11 years old, maybe a little bit, maybe not. I may not have been in high school yet. It may have been before then, and then I carried it with me into high school. But then it was amazing how many people I would meet and relate to because they knew the same thing. Yeah. I could sit there and start
quoting, you
know, it. Start quoting it, and they would finish the line, and I knew this is the, you are one of, you know, we are one of the same.
You're one of the good people.
Yeah. But there's a couple of mine.
Man, comedies. I don't know. I honestly can't think of any like older, like non. Not like beyond like 10 years.
Really?
I don't know. That's a weird one. Just off the top of my head. I'm sure I'm missing a couple. I'm trying to think. Shoot. This is kind of weird, but I guess I'm not really a big comedy guy when it comes to movies.
I was when I was younger.
I enjoy them, but I just don't really... Yeah. Pay attention to them, I guess.
Yeah, I'm the same way now. I don't seek them out anymore, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, you know, 9 times out of 10, there's no story, and it's just kind of like, you know, just a bunch of random things that happen. I will say one of the more recent ones was Just Friends.
Oh, really?
I love that movie.
Ryan Reynolds. That's one I've not seen.
It's one of those ones where, like, if anything bad can happen, it will.
Amazing.
So it can get a little frustrating feeling.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm trying to think. I think the last great comedy that I saw was Anchorman.
Anchorman, yeah, oh gosh.
Because, and that was that's seriously the last time that I remember laughing really hard in the theater at just, because I think Will Ferrell is just stupid comedy, and he makes me laugh. I can't deny it. Sometimes I'm almost embarrassed that I'm laughing.
I know,
at it.
Right?
But it's, you know, his stupid humor. That one of my favorite lines.
Can't forget Elf.
Oh, Elf, of course. You're not Santa Claus. Yeah. That whole scene is amazing.
Yeah.
But I knew that I was going to love Anchorman at one point where he's at the party and he's trying to convince Christina Applegate that he's, you know, some kind of guy, and he starts listing off all the cool stuff about him. You know, I have many leather-bound books, and you know, he starts listing off these 70 stars that have died that nobody knows about.
Yeah.
And it's like Merlin Olsen comes over, you know, every once in a while, and you know, like Merlin Olsen was like a football star from the 70s who went on to get famous on Little House on the Prairie of all things. But anyway, just that stuff, that weird, funny, strange humor I love. And that was the last movie, I think, that really had me laughing pretty much nonstop.
Yeah.
Because it's just ridiculous.
So another, actually, one just popped in my head. I forgot about this because it's actually a very recent one. I don't know if it's considered a comedy. I guess it is. But it was called the Grand Budapest Hotel.
Oh, love that movie, yes.
So good. Like, it's probably one of the weirdest movies I've ever seen.
But
it was so good.
I love Wes Anderson.
It had a really interesting story, and it was really funny at times, and awkward at times.
Have you seen Bottle Rocket?
No, I've not.
Okay, that's Wes Anderson's first movie.
Okay.
And it's it's Owen Wilson and Luke Wilson before kind of some of their earliest roles too. And it's wonderfully strange and hilarious. And he has a whole string of those. There's Rushmore with Jason Schwartzman that is just ridiculously funny. But it's also got this weird kind of darkness behind it that makes the humor even funnier. But yeah, both of those should definitely be on your list if you haven't seen those.
Okay.
Yeah, Bottle Rocket. Oh, then, you know, and Royal Tenenbaums too. That's another one of his.
That's another.
And that one's really weird, but very funny.
Yeah, I don't think I ever actually saw that one.
Well, look at you going.
Let's get a little basement going.
Taking care of business over here.
You using even numbers, throwing me off.
I know, dude. I didn't mean to, but it just happened.
How dare you?
That's because I think I wanted double doors.
Oh, yeah. That makes sense. I'm just trying to figure out where to put this thing.
What? How are we looking on time there, friend?
Oh, we're going to have to wrap it up here.
Well, that's good. I think we just kind of barely touched the surface, and I think we'll kind of get a game plan on how we want to discuss this.
Yeah.
And proceed that way.
And, I mean, I'm sure as well I'll think of some more good comedies. It's just weird. I was just thinking about it. Like, off the top of my head, I can't even remember any.
Woo.
They just don't stick with me, I guess.
To be honest, I really don't seek out comedies. I just thought it would be an easy one to start with. Probably here's why, and we'll end with this discussion here.
Yeah.
One of the first movies that when we first met on your stream years ago, one of the movies that I kept quoting that nobody knew is a comedy that's one of my absolute favorites of all time. I mean, seriously, it's up there with like Raiders of the Lost Ark. I mean, I think it's just a brilliant, brilliant movie, and it's called Joe Versus the Volcano.
Oh yeah.
Loads of people haven't seen it. They don't know anything about it. They've never heard about it. And when they watch it, they're like, how could you like this? And it's because there's something in this movie that speaks to me beyond what's happening on the screen.
Yeah.
And there are certain movies that just do that, you know, like, yeah, and Joe vs. the Volcano is one of them. Yeah. Yeah. And I can't even explain it. All I know is that when I saw it, it hit me in such a way that I remember after the movie ended, I was sitting in the theater, and this is with, look at you.
Ooh.
This is the girl who I dated in high school, and she was like, oh, that was fun. And I was like almost devastated because I was like, how could you say that was fun? This movie is saying some really serious things. And yeah. I was like, we started talking, and she was like, dude, this is just a movie. You're reading things into this. And oh, no, I'm not. I promise. There is some deep stuff in here. This is like the because the whole movie is all about that feeling of ennui of like, you know, where you're like, what am I doing with my life? How I'm spending? You know, he has this line where he says, "I gave my life away for $300 a week." You know, to work in this place with despicable people, with horrible conditions, and for what? Yeah. You know, and it's just that realization that sometimes you have to just go for it. And anyway, there's so much in that movie; it's wonderful. And that's and I think Jill and I were talking about in one of our videos, and I was quoting that quote. That Meg Ryan's character says, and I'll have to look it up and bring it up next time because I don't want to misquote it, but
it's a really good quote.
It is, and the whole movie is filled with stuff like that. And the guy who wrote this, John Patrick Shanley, went on to write Doubt, which won the Pulitzer Prize, and I think won a Tony.
Oh, wow.
It's astounding. Yeah, it's really, really good, and I think people are, oh, this is great. I think people don't give it credit. So anyway, well, I could go on about that movie for hours. Seriously, I love it so much. That's awesome down there.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to bring the wood down here and finish the supports. Sweet. But I guess that's it, kids. Yeah, I guess we'll hold off
for this time.
Yeah, and we will
let us know your favorite comedies in the comments.
Yeah, that's right. Comedies. What a weird way to start. What was I thinking?
Or if you have been to a Comic-Con recently, tell us about your experience.
I've never been, and I really want to go. I really want to go now.
Yeah, you got to be prepared, because there are definitely some interesting people.
I believe it.
Anyways, thanks for watching, everybody.
Yeah, thank you.
See you next time.
I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.